their track. The first rule of mixing is don't change their track. There was one question before, like just at Sunny's thing, that when they send it for the mix, the track gets changed. So whatever they are used to listen to, it's not there anymore. It's very alien. It may be good or it may be bad. That's not the subject, but it's very alien. So the first thing is that you don't change the track. Like you are a mix engineer, they have given you the track and you just take it and you just take the levels anywhere. You take the kick somewhere, you take the bass somewhere, you change the guitar levels, you do anything. So that's not a thing. Today's date, what happens, since earlier when people used to go to studio and record, so the whole sound was dependent on the recording engineer who was mixing it later on in the studio only. So you did not had any reference of any song. You know, you used to call drummer, he used to come play drum and go, or maybe double guitar or tabla dholak or singer. So all your sound was dependent on the guy who's recording it. But now, since it's changed, everything is computer, everything is electronic. You are recording, taking analog source, but you are taking it in a computer. So you have a sound in your brain. When you start a song, you have a sound inside you. As a composer, if you're programming or if you're producing, if you're doing any kind of thing or arrangement or so anything. So the first job of mix engineer is not to change the track and make it so alien for the composer or for the music producer or for anyone that it just distracts them. Ki, oh man, what is this? I have given the track for him to make it, to take it in next level, to the next level, but he's just, you know, I'm demoralized now. So I'm like sad. That should not happen. The whole challenge is to take the track, make it sound the way they have given the balance of the track. Now, it could be anything. They add reverb, they sometimes process. Sometimes you get track as a mix engineer, the process track. The track is pre-EQ'd, pre-reverb process. It's been already compressed a lot. That you have to treat it as a part of that particular sound. So if you get, guitar track, which is very over-compressed or it has a lot of reverbs and delay added in. So don't think that, you know, if I had reverb and delay separate, I would have done a better job. Because at that point in time, you are limiting yourself in a certain bracket. You're not thinking beyond that. You're just putting it on someone else. You're thinking, arre, mujhe milta tha yaar, toh, I would have done a better job. I would have put a better reverb, better delay, or I would have used my hardware compressor. Think it as that is a part of sound. That is the sound which he wants. It's not that he has processed and given me. So as a mix thing, your job is to glue the whole track in such a way where you can listen to everything, but everything has to sound together. It should not sound separate, pokey. Things should not come out so much where it disturbs you when you're putting headphone or you're listening to any song in speaker. It has to have an even form. Now, in that also, there are no rules that your kick has to have this much lows only, your snare has to be this much loud only. Your snare can go plus 6 dB from the track, because that maybe that's the concept of the song. So first of all, thing you have to take care is you should not change the concept of the song, because every song has a story behind it. And there's a lot of hard work of months, maybe year, maybe 6 months, 8 months. And you just can't take it and change it in one day. So you have to play around it, try to make it sound good, and then give it back. And then of course there are a lot of tweaks which goes front, back. It keeps coming and going, coming and going. So that is basically the main base subject. What we have to keep it in our mind is not to change that. Now in there is one another thing, that there are people who just give you some basic track and they say you do whatever you want. Then at that point of time, then you can expand your thought process, do present to them and see whether they like it or not. So first was that. Basically it was just a small intro of the mix thing. Now, so the main thing is you should not be limited on hardware. You can do certain mixes, you can produce very good sound in the box only, and there are a lot of engineers I know. I travel to a lot of different countries. Last year I had gone to LA to some studio. They have this very fancy SSL board, knee board, and everything. And there's this guy, Manny American, he's mixing on a laptop. That is what I used to do earlier. So I used to work in a studio called NYSA. They had this SSL 4000 and 9000 console, and I was so dependent on the board at one point of time that the studio was shut and there was a lot of emergency to, you know, do the mix, and I did not had SSL board. So that time I realized that you should not be too dependent on any outboard gear so that you cannot perform it later on in any other stages. So that pushed me to learn the mixes in the box. Of course, I do use a lot of outboard, but that's for color, as you said. That's that thing only. Now, second thing, I was coming to the arrangement. Now, this is, you know, how important is your thing in the mix, how much you put your brain to do a mix or to process some certain kind of sound. It's that much important for you to arrange the session in a very proper way. Now, as this was already explained by Sunny, that how he arranges the session, I just got a session to show you the arrangement and how it's going to help you. So say suppose this is my, you guys can see, okay. So I think this track is also produced by Sunny only, that's why I can see a lot of chops and cuts, some thousands and thousands of cuts over here. You can see audio production. So this is, I always try to keep my rhythm up because that's the main bed of any song, and then you come to bass, then you come to whatever you like, guitar, pads, live instruments, solos, and then go vocals. Now all these things goes to buses again. So say suppose, for example, the topic of multiple kicks, like you use multiple kicks to get one combined sound. Now you send all of them to one bus, like that I have taken like claps, this to particular buses. Now this helps, as in if you are traveling and you have a very portable setup, and say suppose your computer is not strong enough to, you know, take a lot of DSP, you can use very limited number of plugins and get the sound what you want. You don't have to go on each and every tone, like you don't have to do that. You have to take it on the buses and process and see how much overall processing is making a difference. Because if you go inside the tone and try to process a sound, there what you're changing the musical balance. And that you don't want to do, because you have to stick to the, and as Sunny said, that it's most difficult to get the color rather than doing anything from scratch. It is, trust me, it's very difficult, because most of the time the songs are like 99% set, but they want you to make it sound good, and they say you should not even touch a half a decibel of volume. Now you're taking some vocal and you're EQing it, you do some EQ, you do some kind of compression, your levels will change. Yeah. But you have to, and don't get cheated by, you have done some EQ, of course you have pushed something, your volume is going to go up. When you bypass, it's going to sound dull. When you turn it on, it's going to sound brighter. So basically, maximum time, what mistake we do is we cheat ourselves. We put a compressor, we, in Pro Tools, I believe, the basic compressor has plus 4 dB output. When you, the moment you put, the out gain is plus 4 dB. So we get cheated, oh, wow, we put a compressor and the sound is good. Don't do that. Do your processing, do your EQ, compensate it back, like pull down the volume again, the master volume of the EQ, then you bypass, turn it on, turn it off, and see how much difference it is making for that particular track to sit inside your entire arrangement. So now the benefit of arranging a session in a very proper way, which I used to do earlier, I am not doing it anymore. I just give it to Abhishek because he gets all the torture job from me. So basically, see, if I have a lot of dholak, it's going to one dholak bus. And then if I'm done with all the plugins, like I have a lot of plugins, maybe I don't have in this, but if I have a lot of plugins, it again goes to next bus of dholak to put more plugins. because it has a pre and post. I mix in Cubase, Logic, and all the softwares. Now the thing is that when you are done with your busing, you should, as a major help, always create master buses of each and every section of the song. Say suppose you made the buses of kick, you made the buses of snare, dholak, tabla, high perks, drums, everything. Now you come back and sum it to one master bus of the rhythm section. Now how it is going to help you, I'll show you later on. So you take multiple basses, it's going to your bass, then coming to the master bass. You take, you have multiple guitars, 50 tracks, 100 tracks, 200 tracks of guitars. It's going to multiple layers of buses of guitar, and then it's coming to one master guitar bus. Same way, instruments, all the vocals, choruses and everything. So now why this is important? This is one of the major thing what a lot of people don't do, making the master buses of each and every section. Say suppose you're done with a mix. Now you find it, you know, it's quite nice. Now I'm done with it. Take it out and play. Now you know, voice is not setting. Voice is not cutting through. And instruments are eating up the vocals. You are very happy with the balance of the song. You are like, okay, wow, this is nice, but vocals are not cutting through. What do I do? If you push the volume of vocals, you are going to reduce the other layers of the song, which is trying, you know, the whole glow is happening of the song. So what there these buses comes and help. So what you can do is you can go to each and every master bus section, find out the frequencies. Say suppose my vocal frequency is going in this range, and there are a lot of other guitars and paddings or different kind of instrument which are disturbing the vocals. So you start tweaking, So you start tweaking the other buses, finding out the frequency which are disturbing the vocals, and you just cut in one go. So you make a gap of frequency. You are not changing any balance. You are neither pulling down the guitars, you are not neither pushing up the vocals. You are just creating certain gaps in the spectrum to fit your instrument. So you can do it with the drum. Say suppose your rhythm is nice, your rhythm balance is good, but your bass is not sitting with it. There is something where in 80 hertz or 70 hertz or 100 hertz, it's kind of, you know, not happening. And you have multiple bass layers. You have synth bass, you have top layer bass, you have sub harmonic bass. So there, these simple half dB, 0.25 dB, or maybe less than that, makes a world of a difference. Because on a master stage, when on a mix or master stage, when you're going on the final stage, when you don't have headroom, this minus 0.25 dB, which sounds very small on a production stage, but on a final stage makes lot of difference. I don't know how many of you guys do this, but this is the most important thing what we just overlook it. Okay, track kon arrange karega, you know what, abhi 4 ghante mein dene ka hai. So let me just take and start the mixing, and you start struggling, where is your this portion, where is your other layer, where is your, and this helps for you to add saturation. Now if my rhythms are coming to overall rhythm bus, I can just take this rhythm bus, make a send to some aux, and I can use it as a parallel compressor rather than sending kick separate, snare separate, everything separate. So you have one whole family to either put, process it by a reverb, either make it sound dramatic or saturate it or color it in any way. So that's how the busing helps. This saves, if you're spending time, I don't know how much time it takes for a mix, because it's a very random thing. It may take 1 hour, it may take 1 day, it may take 10 days. So it's a very different topic. It's not possible to finish some certain job in 2 days also. But there are some songs you can crack in 2 hours. And the most important factor of mix is when you're sitting in a song, on the song to mix, if your song is not coming in shape for the first one and a half hour, just leave it. Don't struggle with it. Just close it. Do something else. Maybe take a break, or maybe start some other song. If you don't have very severe deadline, very like we have like a fever, we have deadlines. Like abhi dena hai, raat mein dena hai. So this busing will help you to get your job done very faster, very quick. And coming to the next point, what was that? See, so now arrangement is done, this is done. The most important thing is saturation. Now saturation is something which is, in a very layman way, I say distortion. Now why distortion is important for a sound? Like Arjun also yesterday, he said that when you're singing something, when you're layering something, just try some different frequencies when you're singing. Just go 10 cents up, 5 cents up, or maybe 3 cents down. You'll have whole bigger layer. Your layers are going to sound great. Now what happens in that? That is also a kind of saturation you are creating without any plugin, because you are not giving the layers on an exact frequency where it's going to cancel each other. So basically you are creating harmonics. You are creating different kind of harmonics. You have a C tone going on, but you're adding a not C sharp also. You're just adding 4 cents to it. So it makes your sound thicker, fatter, and it sits with other instrument. And trust me, my tracks are insanely saturated from inside. I don't know, people call me that my stuffs are very clean, but if you see my session, maybe my fader will be going plus 6 dB of something, it will be clipping, hitting, but then I leave it, I pull it down and see whether how it is sounding, because sometimes your clips are creating a particular sound which you want it to be in the song. When you pull it down, it becomes clean. Now this you should do in the internal stage, not on the master stage. Saturate it inside. If you saturate the master, your overall frequency are just going to get mushed up and you'll get harsh kind of sound. Saturate your vocal, saturate your bass. That 8-bit thing what Sunny just showed in the last half an hour back, that is saturation. He's just adding subharmonics, upper harmonics to get the sound spectrum broader so that it just goes and sits with other instrument. Now for me, I'm not an old school guy. Like I don't have that factor, you know, if you have a bass guitar, you should roll up the highs. If you have this, you should cut off the lows. Cut it till 120. Guitars, you should just cut it. I don't follow all that because maybe I've not studied any kind of from any school. So I don't know the basics of it. But I go with how it is sounding, the sound of it. There are possibilities that when you have some guitars coming in or when you have some kind of vocals coming into you, it has a lot of lower frequency, which is not needed, which you don't want basically technically. When you see the chart that, you know, below 100 vocal frequency is not needed, or maybe below 120 or whatever it is, or 200, depends on different kind of music. Now for me, I would first filter it and see how much different it is making in the track. It is taking headroom. Of course, you have extra lower frequencies which is not heard, it is taking headroom. But sometimes these things does the magic. Somehow you get those very, very good tight lower ends because of this. You just try. Just do filter, leave the filter, just try it in the mix and you'll find the difference. These are things which are not explained in any kind of school or any book, because I read a lot of books, I see a lot of YouTube videos in my empty time when I'm not working. What I've always seen, they are just going in a very, isme itna namak hi dalna hai, isme itna shakkar hi dalna hai, should not go more than one spoon, you should not go one, but that's not the thing. Song is a song, it has a story, and that story you can tell any way you want. It has to sound good end of the day. So this was the explanation for this. Now, the reverbs and delays. Now, as one panning question also came in at that time. So now panning and reverb has a lot of important part to play together. So you are mixing a song. You have panned it according to your particular, say suppose there's a box over here. Now these are your tracks. You pan your guitar off left, off right. You pan your pads fully stereo you are taking your drums in center, you have overhead in stereo. So basically, and you have bass guitar to fill up the lower spectrum. You have high frequency. Now you still have lot of gaps between these blocks what you have fit in according to your arrangement and your production layering. These gaps can be filled with reverbs and saturation. So saturation, you saturate it, you add more harmonics. So your bass guitar has some certain 60 or maybe 80. You add top harmonics to that, your bass guitar will come over till here. Your frequency range increases. So that is going and attaching to your guitars and making a glue. They both are getting glued together. So that's filtering and getting it separate is a very old thing, I believe, because now we don't have any kind of, you know, fix. According to every song we work, and every song has a new sound to it. You just take care that when you're doing an album, your album should sound like one album. That's the main factor, and that is color, basically. That you can still do in the box also and out of the box also. So reverb plays a very important part to fill in the gaps. Those gaps, whatever blocks you have put it in the track. Now, everyone takes reverb as a vadi. Reverb dala to matlab, you know, it's like, wow, reverb. There are a lot of people who don't like reverb for the reason because it makes the track mushy. Yeah. It makes it muddy. It makes it, everything overlaps to each other and it makes it sound bad. And that's a whole reason for them to, you know, bounce back to the reverb. Like I mix for Amit Trivedi also. So you'd have seen his tracks are very dry. But there's a lot of reverb happening inside. Because I mix, I know how much reverb I put. So on an overall sound, it sounds very dry, very upfronted. But I tried, and his production is very clean. You can really hear everything separate because he likes the music in that way. So now how do you fill up those gaps? By saturation, but I still have more gaps.